church relationship in church. And today the topic is on the shepherd and the flock. I can't hear myself a little bit more. Serving and following. And the text today will be taken from 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 to 7. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 to 7. Before we read God's word, let us go to Him in prayer. Holy Spirit, be our teacher. Lord, we want to hear the words of man, but only your word, Lord. Lord, as we teach us from your word, we come under the authority. May we learn to be obedient, Lord, what you have to say for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 5. He said, to the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, a witness of Christ's suffering, and one who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseer, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when Christ, the chief shepherd, appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. And all of you, clothe yourself with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you. This is the word of the Lord. The shepherd and the flock. I think what an appropriate message that we need to learn, because we're talking about relationship in the church and what the closer intimate relationship has with the shepherd, with his flock. But as I begin, I'd like to set something that is help us to be clear. First thing is the word called hierarchy. Hierarchy, and I want you us to know that in God's kingdom, there is hierarchy. So that's a given. In God's kingdom, we have God the Father and His Son sitting on His right hand. He sent the Holy Spirit to us. We have the elders and the angels and the archangels. And in God's kingdom, in God's church, there are hierarchy as well. And what's the hierarchy meant for? It's meant for orderliness and accountability. So that we all know, you know, which way to go, who is giving the direction, who is leading. At the same time, we know what is expected of us, so that we can able to give the accountability. So in God's kingdom, hierarchy is meant for that. For without hierarchy, there'll be anarchy. Everybody will do what is right in their own eye. Everybody do what they want to do, and nobody follows anybody, and we're all in different direction. Therefore, I want to say this. Hierarchy is not a bad word. Some of us are fearful of hierarchy. Some of us are fearful of authority, because we have experience where authority has been abused, and that's a sad thing. But that doesn't make authority and submission a bad word. It's just that because it's been abused. So we need to understand that. And the next thing, hierarchy is really, really meant for nurturing and care. The stronger is what care for the weaker. Parents, you care for your children. There is a hierarchy that is there. Bosses in the work, you are supposed to take care of the welfare of the people who work for you. That is hierarchy at work. When you're in the school, your teachers are in authority. They're supposed to care for the student. It is meant for that purpose, for nurturing and care. And therefore, we can understand that in hierarchy, there will be some of us who are called to be leaders, and some of us will be called to be followers. All right? So some of us, let me set that so that as we go along, we begin to understand what the text can teach us today. But first thing, I want to observe that today's text is very interesting. There are four verses to exhort the leader, to encourage, to teach the leader what he must do, how he should do it as a leader. But there's only half a verse for the follower. So today the sermon really main part is for me. Half a part for you. But let me say this though. It's not just meant for me. Because for this word, this four verse that says here for the leaders, he said to the elders among you, I appeal to you as a fellow elder, which means there are elders among you here. I'm appealing to you as elder, a witness of Christ's suffering and one who will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that's under your care, serving as overseer, not because you must, but because you're willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being example to the flock. And when Christ, the chief shepherd, appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. And for the follower, only half of us. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. That's all you need to do. Isn't it easier to just follow? And for the elder, they got so much thing that they tell them. I remember when I was in my home church in Paya Lebar, I was the youth director taking care of the youth. Every year, I bring at least go out for mission trip twice and to bring the young people on mission trip. I tell you, young people, because of their age, sometimes they do not think very much, and therefore it's not easy to lead them. You have to make sure they wake up on time, make sure they clean their thing, make sure they don't get lost at the airport, make sure they brought their passport. And sometimes they question you, why I must do this, why I must do that. So it was tough to lead. And so we constantly want to think that we teach them it's about submitting to authority. Because you want to go together, you need to be able to have that spirit that goes together. So in a way, there's only half of us, but that's all you need to do. And I remember that subsequently, when I went to study in TTC, I kind of relinquished all my position of ministry, but I still be part of the church family. And I joined a cell group, no more as a cell leader, just a cell member. It's so nice to be a follower. And when they organize mission group as a cell group, I go as a follower. So nice. Whatever the leader say, I do lah. And suddenly the burden is off. So I tell you, want to be a shepherd in the church, your burden is a lot heavier. To be a follower, just follow. And that's why it's only half of us. But we're going to unpack this, and there's a lot more we can learn. Let's talk about the leader first. What's the job of the leader? First thing, the job of the leader is to shepherd the flock. As shepherd of God's flock that's under your care, serving as overseer. Now let me pause here for a while. The shepherd does not mean just the pastor. He's talking to the elders in the church and as a fellow elder to all of you. In other words, if you're a lay leader, you are an elder in the church and that's your job too, to shepherd. Okay, your LCC chair, you are in the LCC committee, you are a shepherd in a church. You're a chairperson of a committee of the ministry, you are an elder in a church. You are parents at home, you are an elder in your family. Your job is to shepherd. I would like to say even to the ushers, you are also shepherd because you shepherd every Sunday the people into God's presence. And so all of us, in a way, are leaders. All right, we are all leaders and therefore we are called to shepherd the flock. What does the shepherd do? The shepherd is to care, to tend, to feed them with the word of God, to provide for them, and to protect them, especially when the wolves that come. That's the job of the shepherd. And not only that, they are to serve as overseer. An overseer is one who guides, who directs, and sometimes even the need to discipline. That's what the overseer do. And you know why? Why the shepherd call a staff, okay, that has a hook at the side? Because it's meant to protect the sheep. When the wolf comes, he used to stick to whack the wolf. And on the other side, they use it to guide the sheep. And when the sheep go off the path, the hook is meant to pull them back. And that's what the shepherd do. I like the Anglican church. You know, in Methodist church, the pastor is the number one pastor. Is called the pastor in church. In the Methodist church, it's called a vicar. What does vicar do? Vicar means it's on behalf of the chief shepherd. And so you must remember, the ministry of the leader in the church is to shepherd the flock. And like I says, well, there's four verses that direct at me, I want to say is shared by the rest of the leaders among here. Some of you who are my Facebook friend will notice that the page that I put on my Facebook to always remind me to say this: be careful, pay careful attention to yourself and to all the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseer. Okay, let me read the whole text so that you'll be able to understand again. And this is from Paul's perspective. We read from Peter, now from Paul's perspective when he was leaving the church at Ephesus. And he told them, keep watch over yourself and all the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherd of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. And I have to remind myself that God called me to be a shepherd of all of you, and each of you are bought with Christ's own blood. Meaning each of you are precious, very, very precious in God's sight. And therefore, as leaders in the church, as pastors in the church, we need to take our responsibility as shepherds seriously. It's a sacred and awesome responsibility that all of us has to be shepherds. Cell leaders, you are a pastor in your own way, in a smaller congregation that you are taking care of. You are a pastor and a shepherd there. And we need to take that responsibility very seriously. Let me read some more. I know that after at least salvage wolves will come in among you and not spare the flock. Even from your own numbers, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years, I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourself know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companion. In everything I did, I show you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of our Lord Jesus himself, it's more blessed to give than to receive. So as role as shepherd, as pastors, as leader of the church, our ministry is we first and foremost to shepherd the flock. Let me share with you the next thing that we need to be to know about is the manner we shepherd our flock. In verse 2, he says, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve, but being example to the flock. And the manner we serve must be we are willing and eager to serve. You know, if I can, from Aldersgate Methodist Church, I want to eradicate a vocabulary from us. It's called volunteer. I don't like volunteer. I don't believe God called us to volunteer in his ministry. We are servant of the Most High. You know, when we volunteer, we think that I'm doing God a favor. When I volunteer, I'm doing the church a favor. Whatever spare time I have, I volunteer. Whatever spare money, resources, talent I have, I volunteer. No, that's not the way we should be. We are the servant of the Most High, which must become and serve gladly and willingly and eagerly. Well, you say maybe I try to differentiate between volunteer and professional. I tell you, I also volunteered to be a professional. But the whole point is not about volunteering. I mean, if I came into pastor because I think I'm doing a church a favor, I think I'm God's gift to you, I think that would be terribly kind of wrong thinking. We are God's servant. Only Jesus is Lord. And we need to come and say, Lord, I come to serve you willingly and eagerly. I pray that all of us here, as we serve the Lord, whether we are called to whatever position, even just to tidy the place, we do it eagerly and willingly. And therefore, he also went on to say, and being example to the flock. By our life, we need to serve as example, as we serve the church together. So not only are we called to shepherd the flock, the manner we come, we need to come willingly and eager to serve and be an example. Let me share with you the next thing about our motive. Why do we serve? It says not because you must, not greedy for money and not lording it over those entrusted in you. Not because you must, not by compulsion. So the first thing that I say, vocabulary I would like to eradicate from our service to the Lord is volunteer. The second word I want to eradicate from our vocabulary is this, kena arrow. How many of them you caught yourself saying, I kena arrow. I kena arrow become LCC chair. I kena arrow because I had to be the chair of mission department. I kena arrow. Please don't say that. You're not under compulsion to serve. If you want to serve, serve him willingly and eagerly. Not out of compulsion. To me, if it's so charm to serve, don't serve. Don't serve. I'm not afraid a ministry will die because we don't have people. The Lord has said, the field is white unto harvest. Pray for labor, God will supply. But if you don't serve, I can only tell you this, you are accountable to him. You have to answer to him, not to me, not to the church. If God calls you to serve, we obey. We obey. So don't ever use the word, I cannot arrow. So can AMC, can I say, we are not volunteer here. We are servant of the Most High. I didn't cannot arrow. I came in eagerly and willingly to serve. And not only that, it says we do not serve for personal gain or power. You know, sometimes we think of gain means I can embezzle money. I'm not talking about that. Okay, that's going very far. But subtly, some of us do serve for personal gain. Sometimes we just want to look good before men, seeking approval of people. That's personal gain. And I tell you, I'm not immune to that. As a pastor, I want to be the best pastor I can be. I want to be the pastor that people say, you are a good pastor. But if I serve just for the reason to get an accolade and affirmation from you, I think then I got the wrong motive. And that's the most dangerous point, where our heart can be so deceitful because we bluff ourselves. We bluff ourselves. I was teaching in the Bible class, walkthrough Bible, I already make one mention. The most dangerous time for a pastor to be is when he's most successful. When he do best and well as a good pastor, and the congregation love him. Love him so much that they think the pastor can do no wrong anymore. That's the most dangerous position any one of us can be, at the peak of our success. And all of us start with a right motive. We want to be the best servant of God. But we have to constantly check ourselves that we are the servant of God. We are not the Lord. And therefore, we serve not for personal gain, neither for power. I mean, I hear some people, young people say, I want to be a pastor. I say, why you want to be a pastor? So I can stand on a pulpit and tell people what to do. And we think that as a pastor, we can be here to lord over people. I mean, if that's what you're looking for, you are in the wrong place. Jesus said, whoever wants to be the greatest must be the least. Whoever wants to be first must be last. The Son of Man did not come to serve, come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. And the Lord set the example for us that if we come to serve, not for personal gain. I tell you, if I come in for the salary, you all know I'm a marine engineer by training. I got 3 times my salary out there. But if we come in measuring all that, I think then we are in the wrong place again. Not for personal gain, nor for power. And certainly don't serve out of compulsion. I'd like to quickly read this text, Ezekiel 34. This was the text given to me to study. Part of our training, when I first became or undergoing training to be a cell leader. And before we sign on the dotted line that we want to be cell leader, we have to go through the training first. And this was a text for us to study. And I want to urge all of us here who are leaders in the church to remember this text seriously. It's Ezekiel 34. It said, "The word of the Lord came to me, Son of Man, prophesies against the shepherd of Israel. Prophesies and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord say, woe to the shepherd of Israel who only take care of themselves. Should not shepherd take care of the flock? You eat the curd, clothe yourself with the wool, and slaughter the choice animal, but you do not take care of the flock. You have not strengthened the weak, healed the sick, or bound out the injured. You have not brought back the strays or searched for the lost. You have ruled them harshly and brutally." Very direct word. And it tells us as cell leader, that's one of your important parts. To strengthen the weak, heal the sick, bound the injured, bring back the stray, search for the lost. You know, sometimes I feel very sad that some cell leader make this remark. He says, please don't send new member to my group. Huh? We have been meeting for the last 15 years and we are very comfortable with one another. So don't send in new people, Ken. Is that what a cell leader to be? We are not called to be a cell group for a holy huddle. We are called there to seek the lost, strengthen the weak, heal the sick. And there are some cell leaders say, oh, that one you want to send to me. Please don't. I know that person, a lot of problem, I know. Always come to cell group, we'll talk about her problem again and again, I know. Jintama, don't send me, can or not? And we're told, don't do that. Because what does a shepherd do? The shepherd is to take care of the flock, strengthen the weak, heal the sick, bound the injured, brought back the stray, search for the lost. And so it's a good, important reminder. If God called you to be the shepherd, whether you're the pastor, you're a cell leader, that's our role. I never say it's going to be easy. It's going to be very challenging. So therefore, seek for yourself to be better equipped, to be trained, to learn more things so that God can use you effectively. But we cannot say, I want to choose my sheep. Who God placed for us, we must care. And we do not rule over them harshly or brutally. I must apologize to some of you here that at times in my relationship with you, in my conversation with you, I may come across as hard and harsh. I seek your forgiveness. Never in our heart that we want to do that, to hurt our sheep. But I know when one is hurt by authority, hurt by the pastors, it can be very, very, very painful. And I seek your forgiveness. Having said that, I want to tell you this. When the shepherd get beaten by the sheep, it's also very painful. Sheep does bite, and it's also very, very painful. In case some of you who feel that you need some healing from being hurt by authority before, I recommend a book for you to read. It's called A Tale of Three Kings. Fantastic book. You'll really find that book so helpful. I found that book ministered to me. Even I went through some difficult time myself. A Tale of Three Kings. Take note of that. Let me continue reading here. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and where they were scattered, they became food for all the wild animals. My sheep wandered over all the mountains and every hill. They were scattered all over the whole earth, and no one searched and looked for them. Therefore, you shepherd, hear the word of the Lord. As surely as I live, declare the Lord, because my flock lack a shepherd, and so have been plundered and become food for all the wild animals. And because my shepherd did not search for my flock, but care for themselves rather than my flock. Therefore, O shepherd, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says, I'm against the shepherd and will hold them accountable for my flock. And when I read this and studied this and reflect on this, they asked me this question, do you still want to be a cell leader? My answer is yes. My answer is yes. Willingly and eagerly. Without compulsion. Because why? It's a privilege. It's a privilege to serve the chief shepherd who laid down his life for you and me. It's a privilege to serve. Don't say kena arrow. Don't say I volunteer. No, the chief shepherd called all of us to be part of his team. Let us come and serve. Serve willingly. And so when they call me, do you want to be a pastor? Now the responsibility become even bigger. Are you still willing? I say yes. More than glad. Today, if anything, I can inspire you to come to serve. I call some of you, God may have put a heart in you to come to serve God full time as a pastor. I ask you, respond to him. Respond to him. Don't volunteer. Respond to him. Respond because it's a noble calling to be the shepherd of the Lord. And it's a joyful thing. So do that. Now that I've talked about four verses of the pastors, now I'm going to talk the half verse of the followers. Only one responsibility and attitude, submissiveness. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. That's all we are called to do. In the same way. Why does it say in the same way? Because it's reflecting on the manner that as we follow, we also follow willingly and be eager to serve. That should the attitude that we are to be carrying ourselves as a follower as well. And the leader is supposed to set the example for doing that. And the follow too with that submissive spirit. And having said that, let me clarify some thoughts again. So in the way, the way I mentioned, all of us are leader one way or another. Cell leader, you are a leader in the cell group. Ushers, you are also a leader because you usher people in God's presence. All right, lay leaders, LCC chair, PPRC, chair of ministry, taking of committees, cell leaders, you are all leaders. So we are all leaders one way or another. Even in the home, as parents, you are a leader in the home, and in the workplace, you are the boss, or even you are just a middle management, you still have people under you. So all of us are leaders in one way, and I think the Word of God teaches us, has a place for wherever we are. But having said that, we are all followers also. As a pastor, I have my pastor in charge above me. I also a follower. As a pastor, I'm also ordained and given the authority by the Bishop of Methodist Church. I also under higher. As a pastor, is a track president who says, you go to Aldersgate, you got no choice, you go, okay, yes, sir. Sometimes I want to go out. He said, no, you stay here, okay, I stay here. Yes, sir. And we are all followers as well. But we need to realize that whether we are leaders or followers, what we really have is what I call delegated authority. Delegated authority. It's just like the traffic police on the road. He leave out his hand and all the vehicle will stop. Not because he's Superman, he can stop a vehicle, but because he got delegated authority. He's given the badge, he's given the uniform, and you do that, you're going against the authority of the government of Singapore. But in himself, he got no power. He got authority. And delegated authority. And cell leader, if you are pastoring a small group, remember, you are given delegated authority by the church. You are given that platform to lead, to influence. It's a privilege, but let me say it's a responsibility. Because when we delegate authority to you, it's very possible that you lead this group astray, you know, and not following where the church is going. And I want you to know it's such a serious and awesome responsibility. And when the one above you come to ask you, can I challenge one of the members to come out and serve cell as a cell leader? You cannot say, don't want, cannot. I want him for myself. Because remember, you are under delegated authority. And we serve as a team together for the good of the bigger church. And we are all there for both leaders. We all both are followers, and we need to remember we all have delegated authority. But I think I'd like to go one more step further to talk about followers, all of us, including me as a follower. What does the Word of God have to teach us? And I think Hebrews 13:7 says this very well. Remember your leaders who spoke the Word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their ways and imitate their faith. We are called to remember our leaders who spoke the word of God to you. And one of the very important part of the pastor's job is to teach the word so that your life will be shaped by the word of God. I think in the church, we fail to teach the word of God. We have failed as pastors. It's so important that the word of God is the authority in our life, in whatever we do. And therefore, remember your leaders and consider the outcome of their way. How each of these leaders, whether you're a cell leader or you are the pastors, what is the outcome of your way? How do you live your life, your behavior? I tell you, you like it or not, when you become a pastor, you like it or not, you are a public figure. You don't have a choice. And but we pastors are human too. We are people with feet of clay. We struggle in our families. We struggle with our children. Some of us struggle with our marriages. We are just no different from all of you. And therefore, we ask you to pray for your pastors, remember them. And how do they live out their faith in the midst of life journey and challenges? This is very much part of what they go through just like you. But we need your prayer. You see, this verse is not just telling the followers what to do. This verse actually has a very humbling word for us who are leaders. That we need to live up as a good example based on the word of God. By our outcome of our way and the way we live out our faith, even in the midst of our challenges. We suffer from ill health. We also have a loneliness. We also sometimes feel desperate and sometimes even feel very down. But how do we live ourselves in our life with our faith in God in those journeys? And therefore, we can say, follow us. We are not super sane in any way, just like you. And therefore, this verse, while we ask as followers to remember, and I need to remember, Pastor Lorna need to remember, the leaders above us, is a humbling experience to us. Please remember us. Please consider the way our life imitate our faith. The next one in Hebrew 17 says, obey your leaders, submit to the authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give an account. Obey them so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, so that there will be no advantage for you. Again, we need to learn the spirit of submission so that when your shepherd is called to serve, let it be a joy for them, not a burden. Not a burden. I have served many. I give some examples. Marriage preparation course. I have some couples that went through, and some of them may not be living their life right. And I make a point as a pastor, as a shepherd, I don't just run a marriage course. I don't just come to give good marital advice. I come as a pastor. In that time where I need to tell them the way you're living your life is not right, not correct. It brings me great joy when some of them will listen and choose to walk in the right way. Really bring great joy to journey with them. Yes, they have their struggle. But I also had a couple who come and tell me, Pastor, you mean I cannot sleep together before I get married? I said, no, the word of God says it's not right. And it's not going to be helpful to your marriage. And some of them will even fight with me. Oh, my brother in another country, he served in a leader in a church. No, he also sleep together. Okay, why? They can serve that even as leader. Why cannot I? It's really not a joy, a burden. And sometimes the part of that discipline that comes in. And so sometimes we struggle. We struggle with members who are not willing to walk in the way of the Lord. Now, we don't want to come in the Lord over your life. That's not what we want to do. We just, as shepherd, want you to walk in the way of the Lord. And therefore, we pray. We pray that that's where we are coming from. And so that as you move with us together in the way of the Lord, imitating our faith, considering our way, remember we teach you from the word of God that you will be a joy to serve you, to lead you, to guide you. Let me show you the next one. Pray. Hebrews 13:18 says, pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and a desire to live honorably in every way. I really solicit your prayer, and I think the leaders, the rest of the leader of the church will solicit prayer for each other. See, like I say, much as this verse tells us as followers what we have to do, it's a humbling thing for us as leaders, that we must make sure we have a clear conscience. Well, Paul said, yes, I know I got a clear conscience, but I can say, yes, I got a clear conscience, but I need to realize that our heart is deceitful above all things. Sometimes we think we have a clear conscience, but within us, we have some other ulterior motive that sometimes only the Holy Spirit can show to us. Pray for us. Pray for us that when we serve our purity of the heart, and that we'll live honorably in every way. And so this verse is based both on one part on the followers to please do for us. It's also something the Word of God directing to all of us who are leaders, that we need to learn to always to live in a clear conscience and honorably. So like I said, this verse is meant for both sides. And therefore, we need to remember, consider, imitate, obey, submit, and pray for our leaders. Since we are all followers, including me as a follower, I need to do just that. But you know what's the key to be able to do that as a shepherd, to willingly go down to serve, and for follow to willingly submit? There's one word I want to say. It's called humility. Humility must be the hallmark of every believer. Every believer. The world says you want to be the best, you want to be the top, you climb up. In God's kingdom, it's called downward mobility. You want to be the highest, you go down. You want to be exalted, be willing to be based lower. You want to be number one, be prepared to be the last. We are countercultural. We are different from the world. And for us as Christians, that must be the ethos, the mark that's on all of us, humility. Because to be able to say and to be a shepherd willingly and eagerly, and be example, humility is the key word. For us as followers to be able to say, I'm willing to submit, humility is the key word. Because he went on to say, it's all of you leaders and followers, clothe yourself with humility towards one another. Because God opposes the proud, but give grace to the humble. You know, we like to make this claim. If God is for us, who can be against us? Hallelujah. But let me tell you another version of it. If God is against you, who can be for you? If God is against you, who can be for you? And we say, got this type of verse in the Bible, man? Have. There, you just read it. God opposes the proud. Today, brothers and sisters, if we choose to be proud and arrogant, God will say, he opposes you. He opposes you. I give grace to the humble. And never be pride become a mark for any believers, but humility for all of us. And God will give grace to the humble. And therefore, he said, humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lead you up in due time. In the world where you are in a hurry to get to the top, God says, no, let God's timing bring you up. Willing to serve at a lower level. Be willing to serve. Because in due time, he will lift you up. You know what's the important thing about being able to submit? Humility. And it takes a person with a sweet sense of personal security to be able to submit and be humble. A person who's insecure will never be able to submit or humble. Of course, some of you say, oh, Pastor, you say, I'm humble. Then we say, the minute I say I'm humble, I lost it. Yes, true. So don't try to think you are humble. But on the other hand, he's not talking about, I'm not arguing about, I'm talking about God says you must be humble. And why we can have a sense of security? Because we realize that our security is under the hand of God. God is my ultimate authority. My sense of security, my sense of identity come because I'm a child of God. And my God cares for me. So God will lift you up. And my God cares for me. If God cares for me, I have no fear. whatever position I am, I have no fear, God cares for me. I come under his covering. He is my ultimate authority that I submit to. And that must be the hallmark for us as leaders, as pastors, as members of the church. Let humility be one that governs us, that governs AMC the way we relate and serve one another. And I think the best example we can ever learn is from our Lord Jesus himself, the chief shepherd who called us. He said, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. So don't ever be too proud to think you're the best. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also the interests of others. Now, the Word of God didn't say you cannot look to your own interests. It just says do not look only to your own interests, but also the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ. This is like an order to all of us. Your attitude to be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, something to be hold on to. He didn't hold on to his right as the Son of God on the throne, where he's worshipped by his angel daily. He says, I let go. That's rightfully mine. I let go and I make myself nothing. Taking the very nature of a servant being made in human darkness. He emptied himself to be a servant. Humility, that's the hallmark. Whether we are in whatever position, follow our leaders. Humility, willingly empty ourselves to be a servant. We are all called to serve. And not only he is humble, he became obedient even to death on the cross. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, become obedient to death, even death on the cross. Are we willing to die and be on nothing? God called for us to be willing to be nothing. Nothing for his sake. Only when we are able to empty ourselves, then God can fill us up and lift us up to be indeed his servant, to be indeed his powerful servant, only when willing to empty, only when willing even to die to ourselves, the rights that we have in our life, we are willing to let go and let God be the one who will exalt you up in due time. And that's what we are to be, whether you're leaders or you're a member of the church or followers. Whatever position God calls you, let Christ be that example. And then he went on to say that, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The Lord share his glory with us. The Lord will share his glory with us. But we don't have to chase after it. We don't have to chase after it. Just be willing to walk his way. He'll exalt us. He'll lift up us. And therefore he calls us to do the same. Because he cares for us. God will do just for us. 1 Peter chapter 5 says, humble yourself therefore under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. And when the chief shepherd appears, you receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. If I want glory from God, may the glory not be from man. May the glory be one that the chief shepherd will give me. May we all serve with the attitude that all we want, the affirmation from the Lord who says, good and faithful servant. Let's come with that heart together as a church. If we talk about relationship, talk about humility, let's come together. And like I say, that there are times where as a pastor, they have rule over you harshly. Ask for your forgiveness because that's not the heart of God. That's not the heart of the shepherd. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, speak to us. Even as we come before you, Lord, I ask for your forgiveness. When we often feel, Lord, as your under-shepherd in caring for our sheep, where we let self-interest, our own agenda, even chasing glory, that have overtaken us for our care for our sheep. Lord, I ask for your forgiveness. Teach us, remember, Lord, our first and foremost role as pastors and leaders in the church is to be like you, our chief shepherd, willing to die in our care for them. I pray for our church as we come together united in humility, acknowledging that only Jesus is the Lord of this church and not any one of us here. Yes, Lord, you have instituted structures and hierarchy for the sake of orderliness and accountability, but you also have instituted hierarchy and structure for the sake of nurture and care. May we carry that responsibility with a sense of awesome awe, a sacred awe. May we do it, Lord, eagerly and willingly. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.